So I want to thank the Kennedy Center for their generous sponsorship of this event. And just before we get started, a quick announcement for a new student group, the Peace and Conflict Resolution Society. They are focused on conflict resolution and peace building. And so if you are a student and interested in that kind of thing, they have a sign-up sheet at the back of the room and flyers. They have a lot of exciting things that will be going on this year, so I encourage you to check them out. In his book, Making Peace, Eugene England writes about LDS President Howard W. Hunter, who had recently passed away. And he wrote as follows, President Hunter began his ministry as a peacemaker. His first public comments after being ordained president of the church focused on what became his central theme, peace through Christ-like living. I would invite all members of the church to live with ever more attention. This is England quoting President Hunter. President Hunter says, I would invite all members of the church to live with ever more attention to the life and example of the Lord Jesus Christ, and especially the love and hope and compassion he displayed. I pray that we might treat each other with more kindness, more courtesy, more humility and patience and forgiveness. Our world cries out for more disciplined living of the commandments of God, but the way we are to encourage that, as the Lord told the prophet Joseph in the wintry depths of Liberty Jail, is by persuasion, by long-suffering, by gentleness and meekness, and by love unfeigned. And then England writes, I pray fervently that the influence of President Hunter will continue strongly and will be fulfilled as we try to follow his teaching and example in making peace through the pure love of Christ. The BYU Center for Conflict Resolution is devoted to helping promote peace. And with our annual Peacemaker Lecture and Award, we want to honor outstanding individuals who have who are devoted to that work. And we want to learn from their experiences. This is the inaugural year of the award, and I can't think of a more deserving recipient and someone whose life and work has exemplified the aims that we hope to accomplish than Professor Jim Holbrook. Professor Holbrook has worked tirelessly throughout his career in both practice and teaching to promote peace. And I think the hundreds and hundreds of students that have had the privilege of learning from Professor Holbrook would attest to his kindness and sincerity and wisdom. I just wanted to say a little bit about his background. He's clinical professor of law at the University of Utah. He earned a bachelor's degree from Grinnell College, master's degree from Indiana University, and a law degree from the University of Utah. Practiced law for many years in both civil and criminal litigation, and has worked as an arbitrator and mediator for hundreds of cases. He's taught courses in conflict resolution across the country and around the world, and he's the author of numerous articles and books, including one especially brilliant book titled Advanced Negotiation Mediation, which, by way of full disclosure, I am co-author. Before law school, he fought in combat in the Vietnam War and was awarded the Bronze Star and Army Commendation Medal for Valor. He's provided legal assistance to the government and judiciary in Iraq, rule of law training for prosecutors from Afghanistan, and mediation training for judges and lawyers in India. He's received numerous awards, including the International Academy of Mediators Sid Lezek Award for Excellence and the Utah Council on Conflict Resolution's Peacekeeper Award. It's an honor to present Jim and with this year's award, which is this bonsai tree. And bonsai trees are beautiful, but they don't just happen. They take work and care and attention, and we thought that was a very fitting metaphor for peace building. So will you please join me in welcoming Professor Holbrook and congratulating him on this year's award.
I'm deeply honored to have been invited to receive this award and to give this inaugural talk. I'm really also pleased that there's so many students here. So as I give this talk, I'd like you to run a thought experiment. Think about what your life would be like in the future if you left BYU today and enlisted in the military, and 6 months from now, you were in combat. How would your life change if you did that? So that's the thought experiment to keep in mind, because I'm going to talk about that. I want to recognize my wife, Meg. We've been married 33 years, and she's lived with me much of this karmic journey. And I would not be here without her love, care, and support. Thank you. and I'll try to leave some time for questions and answers at the end. Fyodor Dostoevsky wrote in Notes from Underground, "Every man has reminiscences which he would not tell to everyone, but only his friends. He has other matters in his mind which he would not reveal even to his friends, but only to himself. But there are things which a man is afraid even to tell to himself, and every decent man has a number of such things stored away in his mind." So this is the story of lessons I've learned on a karmic journey from combat in Vietnam in 1969 until today. In Vietnam in 1969, I helped kill dozens of people who only wanted me to go home. Under the law of war, this was justifiable homicide. However, years later, I realized that my killing others in combat in an unnecessary war had violated my own moral code, and I had incurred a karmic debt, which I've been trying to pay off for nearly 50 years. So karma is the set of consequences that are caused by our acts, good and bad, and they affect what is our next state of existence. You know, the Buddhists believe that there are lives after this, but in my case, they've affected my lives like year to year and with these karmic consequences. My karmic journey has been a journey of redemption, trying to find absolution for having done these really immoral acts a long time ago, and to do something about the suffering that I've caused others and to myself. I've learned that only when I remove the harm in myself can I be useful to others. And to remove the harm in myself has been difficult because I first had to recognize that there was harm in me, and then I've had to try to find a way in which to forgive myself of really unchangeable bad acts and try to find meaning and purpose in doing that. So for those of you who are students, this might be interesting. I grew up in a pivotal time in American history. In November 1960, when I was 16 years old, John F. Kennedy was elected president. And in his inaugural address, Kennedy said, "We shall pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe, to assure the survival and success of liberty." Less than 2 years later, in October 62, I was in Boston watching the skies for Soviet ICBMs, truly believing that I was going to be killed in a thermonuclear war between the United States and the Soviet Union. A year later, on November 22, 1963, President Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas. And Vice President Johnson became president, and in 1965, he escalated the war in Vietnam by sending hundreds of thousands of troops to that country. In May 1966, I graduated with a degree in philosophy from Grinnell College in Iowa, a small liberal arts school. And I started graduate school at the University of Indiana, Bloomington, and studied history and philosophy of science. And I thought I wanted to be a small college philosophy professor. But 1968 was a tumultuous year, both for our country and for me. Our country was in the third year of a bloody and costly war in Vietnam. On January 31st, 1968, the North Vietnamese Army and the Viet Cong attacked cities across South Vietnam, and a complete surprise for us and our military. Although the enemy was repulsed by American forces, this Tet Offensive changed American public attitude toward the war in Vietnam. Walter Cronkite, who was the revered CBS News anchorman, went to Vietnam and then had this to say about what he observed about the Tet Offensive. "We came to Vietnam to try to determine what all this means to the future of the war here. It seems now more certain than ever that the bloody experience of Vietnam is to end in a stalemate." On March 31st, 1968, President Johnson had a televised news conference to the whole country and said, "I will not seek and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president." On April 4, 1968, Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated in Memphis, and there were race riots in hundreds of cities around America. The National Guard were called out in many cities, and many large cities looked like a war zone with blocks and blocks of burned out buildings. On June 6, 1968, Robert F. Kennedy was murdered in Los Angeles after he had won the California Democratic presidential primary. Years later, looking back at our country's inexplicable tolerance for guns and killing, which continues to this day, I wrote a piece called "The Meadowlark Syndrome," Wentzville, Missouri, December 1959. A high school friend took me rabbit hunting at his grandfather's farm. I had my father's shotgun and a box of shells. I walked around in the cold for hours but saw no rabbits. At the end of the day, I fired at a squirrel and missed. Then I heard a meadowlark. I crept up and killed it with one shot. I left the meadowlark lying in the snow and went home with nothing to show. I'm going to share with you several short pieces like this, and I think it's important to ask, is this a true story? I wrote this as a reflection about war and killing, and it's like a prose poem, which reflects, I think, the emotional truth of a lived experience, but it does not pretend to be historically completely accurate. So I want you to keep that in mind as I share several more of these pieces with you. So in June 1968, I had 2 degrees in philosophy. I was accepted in a PhD program in philosophy at Yale. And instead of going to Yale, I enlisted in the Army, which is the thought experiment that I've asked you to have. So why did I do that? Why did I leave behind a wife, a life, and a career track in academia that I would never recover? I have no clear or simple answer even today, but another piece that I can share with you is called "Second Thoughts About Joining the Army," Army Induction Center, Indianapolis, June 1968. Was I so helplessly married I had to slam the door on my own confusion? Was I so angry at my father that I had to show him I could overcome comfort and fear? Was I so duty-bound I had to serve America, right or wrong? Was I so curious to see the elephant and see how I would respond? So in autumn 1968, I attended the Army Artillery School at Fort Sill, Oklahoma, and there I learned how to direct artillery fire onto an enemy. On New Year's Day, 1969, I went to Vietnam, and I served as an artillery fire direction specialist with the 9th Infantry Division in the Mekong River area southwest of Saigon. And I fought in combat for the first 4 months I was in country. There's one engagement that sticks in my mind about which I've written a piece called "The Wagon Wheel," which is today's talk. Mekong Delta, Vietnam, March 1969. In the intersection of 5 canals in the Mekong Delta, 7 people in 3 sampans disappeared under artillery fire. I was expert at directing high explosive projectiles to scream from the sky and burst among the living. 8,000 meters and 30 seconds away, I plotted their execution on a sheet of plywood. Years later, I still wonder if we have souls and if those souls can survive our bodies and if those souls can communicate and embrace and cry and forgive. In August 1969, I was one of the first soldiers that Nixon, President Nixon, pulled out of Vietnam as he was beginning to de-escalate the war. I was offered an opportunity to be reassigned to another unit in Vietnam and finish out my 12-month tour, but I declined because I had seen enough war and killing. I finished my military service at Fort Carson, Colorado in March of 1970, and at that point, I was no longer interested in philosophy. I didn't want to be a philosophy professor. Philosophy made no sense to me anymore after Vietnam. Like almost most Vietnam veterans, I had gone to war as with strangers as an individual replacement, and I came home from war with strangers I'd never see again. I did not have a ticker tape homecoming parade, and not even a word of thanks from the government that had sent me to fight in Vietnam. The most eloquent summing up of my homecoming experience is from the book We Were Soldiers Once and Young by Hal Moore and Joe Galloway. This is from their preface to the book. We were the children of the 1950s and John F. Kennedy's stalwarts of the early 1960s. He told the world that Americans would pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship in the defense of freedom. We were the down payment on that costly contract, but the man who signed it was not there when we fulfilled his promise. John F. Kennedy waited for us on a hill in Arlington National Cemetery, and in time, we came home by the thousands to fill those slopes with our white marble markers and to ask on the murmur of the wind if that was truly the future that he had envisioned for us. The country that sent us off to war was not there to welcome us home. It no longer existed. We answered the call of one president who is now dead, and we followed the orders of another who would be hounded from office and haunted by the war that he mismanaged so badly. I came to Utah in 1970 and had the GI Bill, and I decided to use the GI Bill benefits to attend law school at the University of Utah. Then and for years after that, I had obsessive thoughts about the war. I did not talk about the war with anyone. I felt emotionally numb. I was unable to maintain close relationships. I felt hopeless about the future. I did not want to father children. I had trouble sleeping. I was easily startled by loud noises, and I had diffuse chronic anger. All these were classic symptoms of what later were called post-traumatic stress disorder, first labeled in 1980. Many other Vietnam veterans and I were forced by our government to internalize these psychological, emotional, and spiritual costs of going to combat. Sometimes help came to me in the most unexpected places. In 1982, I was taking a writing workshop, and we did a piece on dream writing, and I had had a recurrent nightmare of being chased by an enemy through a jungle, and I'd always wake up before he came to me. And I was writing about that. And the instructor said, the next time you have that nightmare, in your dream, stop and turn and ask your pursuer what he wants. And I did that. And my pursuer embraced me and didn't say anything. And I never had that nightmare again. In the early 1980s, I became interested in negotiation as a better way to resolve problems than litigation. In the mid-1980s, I became a mediator, and at a time when most lawyers thought that mediation was unnecessary and economically foolish. In 1990, I was invited by my law school to become an adjunct to teach negotiation and mediation, and I did that for 12 years until I joined the faculty full-time in 2002. A turning point in my karmic journey occurred in 1995 when my undergraduate school solicited articles from alumni about whatever they wanted to write that were going to be published in a magazine that celebrated the school's 150th founding. In that piece I wrote, "Somewhere I once read that the root cause of delayed stress reaction among Vietnam veterans is guilt. It has taken me 25 years to sense the enormity of killing all those people and helping to destroy their universe. I still dare not look this fact square in the face. Instead, I need to visit the wall, which I have avoided like a nightmare. I also need to return to Vietnam." When I wrote that, I was 50 years old. My admission of my guilt as the root cause of my psychological distress felt right. A year later, 1996, I went to the wall for the first time. I went at night, I was there by myself. I was profoundly moved by the experience. A year after that, I returned to Vietnam and visited the places where I had fought during the war. There I learned that the war indeed was over, and I did not need to carry it around in my mind anymore. My act of writing about this in 1995 was kind of the key that unlocked this journey and made it possible. My friend, author Terry Tempest Williams, has written, "Writing becomes an act of compassion toward life, the life we so often refuse to see, because if we look too closely or feel too deeply, there may be no end to our suffering. But words empower us, move us beyond our suffering, and set us free. This is the sorcery of literature. We are healed by our stories." Let me say something more about the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington, D.C. It was designed by a young woman your age, Maya Lin, who was then a 21-year-old Chinese-American art student at Yale. The memorial lists the names of soldiers who were killed in Vietnam in the chronological order of their deaths. The names are engraved in highly polished black stone panels. And the first panel, as in the real war, has a very few names on it. And the next panel is larger, has more names on it, and larger, and more names, until you get to the middle of the panel, where the panels are high overhead with so many names on it. And then the memorial bends at that point, and the panels get shorter and shorter as we removed more and more troops from Vietnam. So this design, I think, expresses the American experience of being carried deeper and deeper into a war which nobody really understood, with ever-mounting casualties, before we began pulling troops out in 1969 and finally leaving the country in 1975. The memorial is a quiet and sacred place which has inspired visitors to express their own grief, loss, rage, and despair by leaving personal offerings behind at the memorial as gifts to the living memory of their dead loved ones. The wall invites us to reflect on the meaning of patriotism, the tragedy of the war, the blunders of our leaders, the heroism of the dead, and our country's pointless sacrifice of 58,000 lives. My reaction to the wall is expressed in this piece, which I've called Here Our Intentions, Vietnam Veterans Memorial, Washington, D.C., November 1996. "You sacrificed our lives on an altar of hubris. Dismantle the altar and scatter its stones. Lord, hear our prayer. Embrace those in agony who suffer and die. Comfort their loved ones. Heal all the wounded. Lord, hear our prayer. You are our salvation. Grant us peace. Remember our sacrifice and give us meaning. Lord, hear our prayer." Relations between our country and Vietnam normalized officially in 1995. In 2 years later, in 1997, I went back to Vietnam, and I took with me my military dog tags. I intended to leave them behind as an act of atonement there, but I did not know what I was going to do with them. And in my hotel in Saigon, One of the waiters was a Viet Cong soldier who had served for the other side during the Vietnam War. And we had a chance to talk about our experiences. And he said that his parents and a sister had been killed by Americans. And I took off my dog tags and gave them to him. And I said, I wish your children and their children have no more war, with peace forever. And he wrote that down in Vietnamese and gave that to me on a napkin, which I still have. I was in Ho Chi Minh City, which was the new name of Saigon, on April 30th, 1997, which was the 22nd anniversary of the fall of Saigon. So April 30 is kind of like our July 4th. It's their liberation day. And I was in a restaurant across from a square, and there were stands and lights and a riser. And I was really curious to see how the Vietnamese were going to celebrate Liberation Day. And I was amazed and surprised. They celebrated it with a rock concert. And I realized that we had won the hearts and minds of these young Vietnamese without having fired a shot at them. 2 weeks later, I was back in the United States, and I was interviewed on KRCL radio in Salt Lake City. I was asked, what was the lesson that America learned about Vietnam? I said, I think we as a country should be deeply grateful for Vietnam vets who served and who died, because I think they made it possible for us not to repeat the tragic mistakes of Vietnam. Many young American men and women now will not have to die in war without a realistic objective. I think that's the legacy of the Vietnam War. 4 years later, after I said that, we invaded Afghanistan. 2 years after that, we invaded Iraq. We are still in both countries, and both countries are still violently unstable. America repeated in Iraq and Afghanistan the same tragic lessons that we made in Vietnam. We've learned nothing. In 2009, I was asked to go to Iraq to manage my law school's government assistance program, providing legal assistance to the government of Iraq. And I was really excited to go and hopeful that my work there would be a huge step on my journey of redemption. What I found there, however, crushed my naivete. The Shia government of Iraq was using democratization to discriminate against the political and religious Sunni minority. And it seemed inevitable to me in 2009 that renewed sectarian violence would be the bitter future of Iraq. The Iraqi professionals that we hired as translators and interpreters and office staff said that their lives were better off under Saddam Hussein before the American invasion. Then they had water flowing in mains underground. They had electricity 24/7, and there was only one man to fear. And now they had to have water trucked and pumped up to tanks on the roof. Electricity was off for hours every day, and they feared everybody. What I've learned with great sorrow is that my killing of others in 1969 in Vietnam cannot be redeemed, regardless of what I try to do. Instead, I've learned that in some sense, this is a quote, suffering ceases to be suffering at the moment it finds a meaning, such as the meaning of a sacrifice. And Viktor Frankl wrote that in his book, Man's Search for Meaning. The cosmos has given each of us a set of unique talents and experiences, and has asked us to use them in service of others who uniquely need them. And I believe that's the meaning and purpose of life. I cannot prevent or stop war, but I can talk and write about it. And the moral trauma that I have experienced turns out to be, in a sense, a gift that I can use in service to others who have also been traumatized. This makes me accessible to, credible to, and useful to others who have experienced trauma in their own lives. So on the one hand, this seems like not enough to do. But on the other hand, I realized this is something I can do now. And I'm grateful for having been given that opportunity. I believe a life of meaning and purpose and service to others promotes peace. It is our responsibility to understand, protect, sustain, and transmit personal, human, and transpersonal values that promote peace. The Pueblo poet Simon Ortiz, in his book, The People Shall Continue, has written, "We are all people of this land. We are created out of the same forces of earth and sky, stars and water. We must take great care with each other. We must struggle to share our human lives with each other. We must ensure life continues. We must be responsible to that life." Thank you.
Thank you. We have about 10 minutes that we'd like to use for question and answer. We'd invite you to come up to the microphone since we are recording. Tell us your name and what you're studying, and we'd love to hear your questions for Professor Holbrook. Please.
Hi. I'm Kevin Huffner. I'm studying international relations. So you've demonstrated sort of the dangers of military interventionism, but I think history has shown us other examples where a lack of military intervention has led to similar problems, if not worse, atrocities such as the genocide in Rwanda. Is there no such thing as good war? You know, is military interventionism ever warranted, in your opinion?
I think that's a very important question. The greatest generation fought World War II, which I think was an existential war. You know, certainly the existence of European countries and perhaps also the United States was at risk because of Germany and Japan. So I think that kind of war clearly was necessary. But if I'm really talking about especially Vietnam and Iraq. And these were elective wars where there were no national strategic interests of the United States at stake. We had no idea how to get out of them. We had no idea what victory would look like. And we just continued to pour more and more blood and treasure into those countries for years and years and years. What is a good war? I would think that if the United States is threatened existentially and our strategic interests are threatened, then I think we have to fight. But I think we also need to avoid these elective wars that have really no purpose and just tragic ends.
My name is Gavin Chatterley, and I'm studying psychology at BYU. And my question, you mentioned all the harm that you felt like the Iraq war brought, and I was wondering what you felt at this point would help Iraq as a country the most.
Boy, I really despair for Iraq. ISIS, I think, is a creation of the Sunni minority. Many of the ISIS leaders are former Iraqi military, and we disbanded the Iraqi military as the second thing that we did when we invaded Iraq. And let me ask you this question. What's wrong with the idea of firing people who have military experience and weapons and forcing them to go home with no income? So that's what we did. The first thing that we did was we debathified the country. We fired all the Baathists who had run the country, and So we made really, really, really stupid blunders at the very beginning of the invasion. I just don't see a happy outcome for Iraq. I think it's likely to be partitioned into three pieces, a Shia in the south and east, Sunnis to the west, and the Kurds in the north, which is something that one of our leaders had suggested back in 2005.
My name is Jacob Lithgow. I'm a molecular biology major.
Good.
My question for you is, today we have many, many soldiers serving in places like Afghanistan, Iraq, and most recently in Syria. If you were there and you could speak to them today, what words of wisdom would you give to those soldiers?
Well, I work with, that's a good question. Part of my service to others right now is I work with young student veterans at the U who've come back from combat. And even though my combat experience was so many years earlier, we can relate. I have a clear understanding, I think, of the sacrifice that they and their families have gone through. And what I try to do is help them with this reintegration that they have from combat to classroom, and help them recognize that they have so much to contribute to others, especially from their experiences. And so I assume that you folks have student veterans, recent student veterans here on campus, and so reach out to them and support them in their reintegration efforts.
Hello, sir. My name is Philip Twergui. I'm a political science major. With history showing after World War II a lot of failed U.S. attempts to spread democracy through military intervention, how would you recommend the U.S. use its soft power to spread democracy? How would you recommend we go about doing that?
Yes, an important question. Google something called the National Strategic Narrative. This was written by two senior strategy aides to Admiral McMullen when he was the chair of the Joint Chiefs. And I think that the National Strategic Narrative really is a blueprint for us going forward. And it really emphasizes the value and the power of soft power, and which we have ignored, I think, certainly since 2001. So I do think that that is a very hopeful document about how we could pivot the United States and pursue really historical American values in the future.
Hi, my name's Ryan Newell. I'm Middle Eastern Studies Arabic major here. I really appreciated your personal story about your reconciliation and peace that you made with yourself. And just wanted to ask you what your opinion was on how we could make that a more widespread phenomenon in some of these war-torn societies. Thanks.
Well, one thing, because I talked about how important it was for me in 1995 to write my story, because I felt like I had lost control of my life, certainly lost control of my story. So I think writing about trauma is extremely useful. And then we need to encourage trauma victims to realize that rather than this being a deficit in their lives, this is really something that they can use to serve others who have been traumatized. When I talk to mediators, for example, I really emphasize that in our culture, we tend to hold trauma away from us at arm's length as something that is not good. But we need to embrace that and to incorporate that as a part of who we are, and recognize that in some way we have been given that experience. And the purpose of that, I think, is to put it into service of others who need our help. So that's my thought about that.
First, I just wanted to say thank you. My name is Joseph Smith. I'm studying international relations. 2 years ago, I had an opportunity to attend a lecture and conversation with the ambassador of Vietnam, looking back and the current relationship and legacy of the Vietnam War. He spoke on the fact that he considered it mostly to be a war due to ignorance, and that the current view that they have is kind of an attitude of forgiveness, but they still don't want to associate with Western values, despite the fact that we are integrally connected. Looking forward now to Iraq and Afghanistan, the two situations that you mentioned have a likeness that we're in now. What do you see that could be a similar outcome, that our desire to bring democracy and the Western values will backfire and lead to a disdain of them despite forever being connected? Or do you see that there might be some way to actually leave that mark on the countries we're in now?
Well, Bush 43 had as a strong political belief that we needed to bring democracy to, especially in the Mideast. And there was a profound belief, I think sincere, that democracy would lead to, to the Arab Spring. And I think just the opposite has happened. I think democracy has been used, certainly in Iraq, as an instrument of ethnic cleansing and real discrimination against a minority. And I think ISIS has grown out of that democratization. And so I think we need to be very, very thoughtful about imposing, especially by force, things that are important to us on societies that don't have our traditions and values.
Hi, I'm Katie Smith, a political science major, and most of this discussion has been about the international turmoil. But you alluded to the continued violence here within America. So how do you see us steering away from this tolerance towards violence here?
Boy, I am so discouraged about that. I mean, we all know now how much gun violence there is in schools and theaters and offices, and we know how much gun violence there is in cities, especially between police and African Americans. And we also know that every attempt of thoughtful people to try to put meaningful restrictions on gun ownership, have not worked. And I don't see that in my lifetime they're going to work either. So I'm very discouraged about that.
My name is Michaela Dunlap. I study sociology here. You mentioned that you believe that the cosmos have given us each individual talents and things that we can use to benefit each other, and that's the meaning of life. In your opinion, how can we be sure that we're reaching our potential and not just saying, oh, I've done enough? What can we do to really affect the people around us?
Well, for young people your age, you have a lifetime of experience and growth and maturity to look forward to. And I don't think that we've ever done enough in this existence. I mean, one of the LDS tenets that I find very attractive is this notion of eternal progression, that we're always growing. And so I don't think we ever know enough. I think there's always more for us to learn, and always more for us to do in service of others.
Sir, my name is Sergeant Pierce Bennett, U.S. Army. I'm studying political science. So you talked about the Vietnam War. I even wrote down my question. Let's see if I can read it. How did you justify bearing the burden of a decision that was not your own, but a decision that was made from others?
That's really important. It's our civilian leadership, and therefore really indirectly all of us, who are responsible for our country's decisions to go to war. So if there had been no war, I wouldn't have gone to war. And we need to be very concerned about putting young people in harm's way, because a substantial percentage of these, and there's a debate about what the percentage is, will have these kinds of profound adverse emotional, psychological, and spiritual consequences from combat service. And they are a true cost of war. We're doing a much better job today with our young veterans from Iraq and Afghanistan through the VA, providing them with counseling and support, which we did not do in Vietnam. But there is a harm that occurs in combat to many people, and we don't understand to which individual it will occur. People are beginning to study that too. But it is a cost of war, which I think we as a society must be willing to pay. And it looks like for our Iraq and Afghanistan war veterans, we've decided to be responsible for this for the rest of their lives, which I think is the morally responsible thing to do as a society.
My name is Leah Brantley. I am a political science major and a computer science minor. And we talked a little bit about how we can heal some of the issues in these foreign nations as well as for our veterans. But I'm curious, as a civilian individual, what we can do on this level on how we can help heal some of these cultural wounds, so maybe as the generation that comes forward, we'd be more prone to negotiate versus initiating violence and that sort of thing.
Well, Bush 41, for example, in the first Gulf War, attempted to negotiate with Saddam Hussein to get him out of Kuwait. And then, when that was clear that wasn't going to work, assembled a huge coalition of overwhelming force and had a very clear objective, which was to get Iraq out of Kuwait. And you know, there were relatively few casualties from that war. One of the things I think that was Corey mentioned to me earlier was that the Kennedy Center has a relationship with the Peace Corps. I really think that these individual kinds of efforts really make a greater contribution to the lives of other people than things that we do either through USAID or the State Department. The program I ran in Iraq wasted $10 million of your taxpayer money. It would as much a waste if I had stood here and were burning $100 bills. I mean, it had that much good effect on the ground in Iraq. Well, thank you. I think, again, I'm very honored and humbled, really, to be invited. And I'm pleased that there's so many young people. And I do this thought experiment. Play it out in your mind. And how would your life change if you left BYU today, joined the military, and was in combat in 6 months? And then think about how you can use your talents and experiences to serve others who uniquely need them. Because I do think that that's the meaning of life. Thank you so much.